Blackstone Audio presents Thrilling Days in Army Life by General George A. Forsyth. A Frontier Fight. More than 25 years agone, it so fell out that I was an actor in one of the most important Indian campaigns of the last half of the present century, the second of a series of four such campaigns, all fought since our Civil War, that finally broke down the power of the various semi-united tribes, compelled them to accept the reservation system, and has practically ended savage warfare within the present limits of the United States. Not that I regard the Indian question as settled, for we still have to face some knotty problems regarding the final disposition of the red men, and it is not at all improbable that within the next decade there will be more or less fighting of a sanguinary character until eventually a fixed policy regarding the Indians will be evolved, and their gradual absorption into the body politic will take place. It is the story in detail of one of the frontier fights that occurred during the second of the four campaigns above mentioned that I now propose to tell. In the summer of 1868, I was on duty as Acting Inspector General of the Department of the Missouri, serving in that capacity upon the staff of General Philip H. Sheridan, who was then in command of that military department, with headquarters at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. The geographical limits of the department included the states of Missouri, Arkansas, and Kansas, and the three territories of Colorado, New Mexico, and Indian Territory. Incidentally, the campaign of which I write carried us somewhat beyond the above-named limits on the north and into northern Texas on the south. However, within the boundaries I have named, many of the tribes who at that time were either openly or covertly hostile to the government had their hunting grounds and roamed at will over the plains and along the frontier from northwestern Texas on the south to the British possessions on the north, having for their habitat all of the then unsettled country east of the Rocky Mountains. In those days it was an Indian paradise, for within a few miles of the most advanced settlements, plover, quail, and grouse sprang into the air with a startled whir and fluttered away to cover in every direction as the early traveler urged his horse along the trail or through the thick grass that bordered the path on his journey's way. Wild fowl of almost every variety nested and raised their young fearlessly in the reeds along the course of the rivers and among the lakes and swamps of the south and west, while vast flocks of wild turkeys feasted and fattened on the hazel and pecan nuts of Indian Territory and Texas. The mountain streams were filled with trout, and far in the rugged depths of the Rocky Mountains, brown, black, and grizzly bear, together with wildcat and mountain lion, gave the added zest of danger to the Indian hunters. Bands of elk and antelope and herds of deer ranged at will along the streams and among the foothills of the mountains, while the great plains were at times covered as far as the eye could reach with vast herds of buffalo, which grazed, comparatively unmolested, from Indian Territory on the south to the badlands of Dakota on the north. During our great Civil War, from 1861 to 1865, the western and southwestern frontier had in many places receded. The Indians had become possessed of firearms, in some cases of the most modern invention, and with their warlike instincts were quick to learn their use and prompt to apply it in action, and in the absence of government troops had pressed back the advancing lines of settlements, harried the weaker hamlets, killed the scattered frontiersmen, outraged and murdered their women, and carried their younger children into captivity. Upon the reoccupation of the southern and western frontier by government troops at the close of the war, the Indians, who had grown confident in their own strength, were greatly exasperated, and the construction of the Union Pacific Railroad across the continent to the Pacific coast, directly through their hunting grounds, drove them almost to frenzy. The spring of 1868 found them arrogant, defiant, and confident, and late in the summer of that year, they boldly threw off all concealment, abrogated their treaties, and entered upon the warpath. I have lying before me, as I write, a tabulated statement of the outrages committed by the Indians within the military department.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.